Could you tell us about your early dream life? Is there anything there that you feel is interesting or unusual that you'd like to share with us?
When I was about 7 or 8, I had a small collection back to back of these very vivid, vivid dreams. Almost unsettling vivid dreams, which made a huge impact on my waking life many years later on, and only to this day, 33 years old now, I recognize that these dreams were actually formulated in such a way which made me intrigued about the topic of dreams in general. They really did boost my interest in dreams because of the content and the meaning behind them. For example, there was one that I remember, and this is the very first dream that I actually recorded into my dream memory, you could say. I'm on a motorbike and I'm going through this computer-like sort of virtual reality environment, and I'm literally just bouncing the bike, as it were, up and down into these small pools of mercury. And I'd bounce in and out of these small puddles of mercury, and then at the bottom I would just do this skid, and then I'd come off the bike, and then I'd be in the midst of holding the biggest giant boulder, you could say, or the biggest rock ever created with my hand, with one hand, and I could feel the immensity and the weight of this boulder. And then on the other hand, I had a feather, and it was weightless, but I could see it. So I had two extremities, two polar opposites in weight. One which was just extremely, you know, heavy, and the other weightless. And I just remember very distinctly in that dream that I was in the middle of those two weights, and I could just feel that even though they were completely the opposite, there is a balance there. They come from the same place. And so there was always this center point for me. And only just now have I realized, you know, practicing lucid dreaming and seeing the relationship between wake and dream, how there is this beautiful, harmonious dance between the two realities, with man standing directly in the middle. And how man operates his own being to be in the center of all things, you could say, you know, in the yin yang of life. This really obviously is the basis now of my research, of my dream research. And I believe that maybe this dream came to me so long ago to teach me that, you know, but it took me so long to work it out and to realize how beautiful, you know, these dreams can be. Not only that did I experience these vivid dreams, I also had sleep paralysis, which is famously known for when your body is asleep but your mind is awake. So you're in this, again, this in-between state, not really knowing if it's real or not, you know. Some people believe that it can get quite unsettling sometimes, you know. The feeling of a pressure on your chest, or maybe a dark entity has entered the room, dragging off the bed and such. This is the mind playing its tricks. And so at an early age, I didn't really understand what all that was. I mean, I have very distinct memories of seeing these beings in my room at night, even though I knew they weren't there before. And it would just, again, excite the meaning and the power of dreams and what it is to become aware within the dream state. And so this propelled my interest even further.
When did you first learn about lucid dreaming? Can you remember your first time and what prompted the lucidity in the dream space?
I guess what really prompted my lucid dreaming practice was when I was kind of in my mid-20s, and I never even heard of lucid dreaming before. I never heard of that term or really had anything to relate it to as such. But still, dreams were evident in my life. They were always there. I could always remember my dreams. Until I decided to take up meditation. And this is really the first point of when I took it to me identifying the experience known as lucid dreaming. And I would meditate directly after I'd finished work in London. And I'd find that meditation, even for 10 minutes or just calming my mind, would just be very, very relaxing. It began to be a very pleasurable experience. And I did this every day. And I would expand the time in which I do meditation by another 10 minutes every week. So in the end, I came to about 45 minutes of meditation or up to an hour, sometimes 2 hours. And I would sit there until one day, after about three or four months of meditation, not expecting anything, I would just be relaxing there, you know, sat up straight with a pillow behind my back. I had my legs crossed, and all of a sudden I felt this tingling which started from the base of my spine and around my legs and feet, actually. And it was like a warming tingling feeling, and it would just slowly expand. And I would observe this feeling. I was like, okay, that's a bit strange. Where is it coming from? I thought it would pass, but instead it just kept growing and growing and growing and getting stronger and stronger and stronger. And then I had a feeling of bliss, blissful happiness, I guess you could call it, joy, very beautiful, very warm, very relaxing, and it was a tingling, you know. But it almost became unsettling because it actually grew and grew and grew to the point where it would shoot right up my spine. And this is all within about 4 minutes. And it went all the way up this energy, up to my head. And then where my third eye is, which is the center of the forehead between the eyebrows, I would feel all of a sudden this immense pressure directly in the center of my forehead. And I was like, whoa, what is that? This is like a physical response to something. I don't know what happened there. Was it because I went quite deep into the meditation? Was it my time to open up the third eye? Well, I don't know what you know. I never even heard of the third eye before. But this pressure in between my eyebrows in the center of my forehead began to be quite an entertaining thing. And I would, after that, I was just like so... I had to pull myself out of the meditation because it was too much. And this tingling kind of dissipated. And from that point on, I would always, within conversation or if I was at work or on the way to work, walking, I would focus on this exact spot. And I could learn to activate that same pressure feeling just by concentrating on that point. And literally within 10 seconds, I could feel the pressure again. And it began to be a very entertaining thing. but what I didn't realize was there was knock-on effects from doing this daily. I didn't realize this, but I was actually energizing with focus intent on my third eye, which is closely related to the pineal gland, I guess, in the center of the brain, which also operates melatonin. And now the scientists say that melatonin plays a key role in lucid dreaming, or dreaming for that matter. So it's all connected. And I would then discover a lot more lucidity. You know, I would miraculously become very aware within the dream state without doing very much. I would be activated within the dream state. And it usually happened within the dream itself at that point. It was mostly, there'll be some odd occurrence in the dream, and I would say, okay, that's not quite right. And then I would say, oh yeah, I'm in a dream. This must be a dream, you know, as you do. And these are called DILs, aren't they? You know, D-I-L-D. Dream-induced lucid dream. And very, very common, you know, to be activated within the dream. It's usually the first step to lucidity. And this would happen time and time again. The more I use my third eye power, you could say. So yeah, that was the main start for me. And then I got as many books as I could on what this conscious dreaming malarkey was. I didn't even hear of lucid dreaming until I researched it, and then I found many, many books. I first read the Stephen LaBerge book, The World of Lucid Dreaming, and then I read a lot of other bits and pieces, and you know, it began to be a bit of an obsession. The more I found out, the greater the experience became. And then astral travel also happened within me months after, and I could learn to do it at will. So that's really what prompted me, really. It was meditation. And even to this day, I still do meditation as a part of my practice.
What motivated you to take it all much deeper?
A few years after me understanding that lucid dreaming was completely where I wanted to take my life, I decided to look into it much deeper and be open to the fact that there were multiple levels to this. I was very, very fortunate to have an extraordinary experience within the lucid state, you could say, where I was greeted by the most beautiful dream character, who called himself my spirit guide, and for me that was incredibly miraculous, because before that time I was actually I took a major interest in these dream characters in general. I wanted to find out where they came from, what did they represent, why were they here in my dream, and I would go around asking all these characters. I would just go up to them and ask them these things, a bit like you know, a detective would do. Just go around questioning people. And I'd do this for a good year or so, and then record all their responses down religiously into my dream journal upon awakening, just logging every type of response that came about. And there were things that came up, you know, they would represent some subconscious fears, and sometimes it was nonsensical stuff, you know, sometimes they'd come out with absolute gibberish. And I always have like a glazed look looking through me. And then other times that'd be quite interesting. And there were actually this small collection of beings, I'd like to call them for the sake of this explanation. Beings that I would call spirits, because about 30% of these characters, I'd say, are very, very different in terms of how I felt as a dreamer at that moment in time when confronted with them, or when I was interacting with them. I would feel a great sense of, oh, there's a presence there, you know. Like when you stand next to someone and close your eyes, you can't actually see them, but you can actually feel them. Feeling, you know. You can actually feel them intuitively, that their presence is right in front of you, and they emit some kind of energy field. And very witty as well, very intelligent responses, responses that you thought could not even come from such a place within you, or predict, as it were. It kind of reflected into my waking life, because my life began to really shift into a whole new direction. I came to a point where I was lucid dreaming at will. I reached a point where I did all the flying, I ate all the big chocolate cakes. I you know, I did all the fun stuff, you know, astral sex and all that, you know, all the mundane stuff. But really, I knew there must have been something deeper, something more that I could take away and find. And I felt that there was an intelligence watching me as well. It began to be more of, the more I questioned these characters, the more of this weird, unknown, alien, for lack of a better term, I could feel like there was this alien intelligence watching me, or watching over me, whilst I was carrying out all of these lucid objectives within the dream state. And so I'm flipping back and forth to my waking dream life, so please bear with me. And then I became redundant in my job. I had to leave my job unexpectedly. So me and my partner decided to sell all our belongings. We thought, you know what, let's just leave the system, let's go traveling, and we decided to go to India. And we visited a lot of temples, I meditated a lot, took my meditation into a much deeper place. And I remember buying this beautiful journal that I would log all my new dream adventures. And funnily enough, my dream capability, my lucid skill, really, really ramped up when I was in India for some reason. I don't know if it's because I was moving the energy more. I was now more free in my life, so there was less stress, you know. And I just felt completely, free and liberated, you know. It was a wonderful, wonderful time. And so my dreams were reflecting this freedom. And then I started to study my, whilst in India, I studied the dream journal that I got. And I could see that there were these entries of an old man in there. He was always old man in, pub, or old man and something, old man and castle. I mean, I wasn't very adventurous with my dream titles back then, but I'd always make sure that there was this old man in there, you know, if he ever did turn up. And I didn't realize this until I looked through them. This symbol, you could say, or this character, this mysterious character, he just kept cropping up for whatever reason. And why was he there? You know, what was he trying to teach me at that time? So I thought, this is very mysterious. Who is this character? So one day I became completely lucidly aware. It was an astral experience, actually. So it was a very high definition, very detailed, so much awareness within that state, environment and myself. And I basically summoned, I just intuitively thought, I'm going to summon this character. I'm going to call him out. I'm going to find out who he is. So I shouted out, spirit guide, spirit guide. And I don't know why I said spirit guide. It was just a term that I thought, you know what, that seems appropriate right now. So it was intuitive, you know. I shouted it out. And I could see that there was this old man on a bicycle who went whizzing past me, almost knocking me onto the dream floor. And he would ring his bell as he quickly went past me. And it was the same character that I saw in about, well, a good collection of dreams before that. And he has white longish hair to his shoulders, quite scraggy looking, tall and gangly like me, with a hat and a long raincoat. Very, very odd. And I would say, hey, stop. And he stopped on his bicycle. He looked back at me, and there's this old man, old wise man. And then he came back. And then when he came back, we decided to sit on a nearby bench. And then for the next 15 to 20 minutes, or dream minutes, you could say, I would say, who are you? I've seen you in other dreams. Why are you following me? Who are you? And then he said, I'm your spirit guide. And when he said that, the biggest amount of love and relief, you could say, just overwhelmed my dream body, you know, to the point where you just burst out crying in the dream state. You know, you just bawl your eyes out because you're so emotionally overwhelmed by what's just happened. And that kind of happens at times, I think. But this time it was different. It was more like, oh, I know who you are. It's like I already knew who he was, and he already knew who I was, and he knew me better than I knew me. And so the adventure continues. He was just explaining how he's been watching me my whole life, and he's here to help me at this time, to get me through this period. And for the next 3.5 years, he and I would go and do some incredible adventures, and hopefully we can get into that later into the show, because these adventures go on and on and on. I mean, I've got like 5 or 6 journals worth of adventures with the same character. And I eventually got his name. He didn't want to give it at first because he said it's not a human, it's not a need in their world to give out these labels to each other, because they use intuitive knowing to know who each other is, if that's the right way of putting it. They don't need a label like, you know, a name like John or Bill or whatever. They use their sensing faculty to understand each other, to know who it is. So not only did I break through the boundary that day of, wow, went from dream characters, nonsensical dream characters who look straight through me as a robot, to there is a character who is repeating now, visiting me in many, many dreams, and now offering guidance, and now wants to make a friendship. And this took many, many, many times to actually build up the trust. It wasn't just like, okay, I just surrendered and I just summoned him and we went off. There would be a lot of trial and tribulation. You know, it would take a long time for me to trust this character. But in the end, through understanding what teachings this character was giving me. I understand that this character now is completely my spirit guide, or one of, and wants nothing but love for me, and wants nothing but me to evolve correctly along my path. And he taught me many things about the lucid state as well. And it's almost like he trained me within the dream state of how to be a decent dreamer. And I wasn't even teaching at that time, but that was one of the things we worked on together. He was kind of edging me towards that, saying, you need to teach this, get over your fear of public speaking. And from there, I can help you. And through many lucid conversations and activities, we would overcome these fears together. So that was my main motivation to take it so much deeper. And that's what prompted me to write my new book, or the first book I wrote, which was Spirit Guided Lucid Dreaming, available on Amazon. So go and grab a copy if you've not read it yet. And even that, you know, when I was writing the book, it felt like he was telling me to get this out there and not worry about what people are saying. You know, don't think too much what other people think, because that also was one of my biggest fears, you know. Worried about what others may think of me, and, you know, it's just the ego, you know, scared of this, of being judged, because it's probably too out there, this whole concept about meeting a spirit guide in a dream state. And, you know, you take those teachings back into your waking life. I was completely scared, even like what my family may think of me, you know, would they think I'm crazy? But in the end, I wrote it, I took a leap, and it was the best thing I ever did. And to this day, I think, wow, what a gift that was that I received. So very, very motivated. And there's so much more to find out about spirits in general. So this is where my research is right now. And I want to learn more about them and share with the world what's happening.
It's time for Now, I have two questions.
Could you talk a little about how lucid dreaming has offered you a new perspective on life and, quote, reality?
Obviously, when I started out lucid dreaming, I never really thought about how it would impact my waking life as such. This is a very, very deep concept, which I believe that happens to a dreamer a few years later after finding one's own feet in the lucid state, because it's just so incredible just to get used to the fact that you can become aware of it in a dream. You can manipulate objects, you can walk through walls, you can breathe underwater, you can fly, you can do all those incredible things. And this can take up a lot of time, you know, and there's no time limit. There's no time in which one should actually, you know, do all this recreational activity. I thoroughly recommend it. I still have a bit of recreational activity in the dream state because that's what we're here to do. We're here to experience. But for me, especially with the meditation and going to India, I kind of realized that there is a deeper level. And obviously working with my spirit guide especially. And this really made me have a new perspective on life and reality for that matter. I started to realize that the more I was actually in the lucid state, the less grip I would have on waking reality. But that's because my story was different, I guess. I don't know if it's the same for everyone. I can only speak from experience. But when I was completely coming out of my body, day in, day out, without any intention, just popping out, you know, mixing with spirit guides and just going through dream wormholes and going through some crazy experiences, I did feel fairly ungrounded. But that's because I went all in. I did it all. I really went for it head first. And I was beginning to think, when I woke up, I thought, okay, so this is the waking world? I mean, is this it? You know? I thought, is that it? This is it? This is what we wake up in? So which one is a dream and which one is reality? It was like, I was very floaty and ungrounded. But that's because I decided to go on an ungrounded adventure. And that's okay sometimes. You know, there's no right or wrong. What I didn't see coming was this. There was a huge golden lesson for me. After that time, I decided to work my way back in terms of, I had all these amazing dream experiences. And then I came back to the West, to France, to have my son, Sasha. We wanted to have a semi-stable life again. You know, we were tired of being on the road and we just need to have more of stability. During that time, my lucidity went really down. There was block. I had a block there for some reason, and it was tough because I had so much going on in my waking life at that time. Lucidity was spontaneously happening probably like once a month, maybe twice a month. Very, very not so good. But this is what it taught me. It taught me to find the dream, find the magic back into waking life, and I only found that out recently. So I had a very ungrounded experience at the start, popping out of my body, going all over the shop, to having almost zero lucidity, but knowing that in this waking world, there is a beautiful, beautiful dream playing out. Because it made me try and search for the magic in this waking world that we live in every day. I wanted to find the magic because it just didn't make sense to me how one reality can be so miraculous, while the other reality that we spend most of our time is kind of semi-normal and not much magic happens and it's a lot of effort and it's very solidified. That's the only way I can explain it. But what I found was that there were these symbols, you know, like dream symbols, like an object or an odd occurrence that's happening or a number repeating or, you know, you keep seeing eagles flying above your head. These weird occurrences started to happen in the waking world, which made me think, wow, you know what? There's actually dream symbols in the waking world. All we got to do is be open to it. So this made me see that there is actually a type of dream happening right now. It's a perspective thing, I guess, right? This is the way of how you perceive life. So now the beautiful thing is that now I see both realities in a beautiful half and halves kind of situation. It's very balanced. You know, one is not better than the other. And you know what? When you say one or the other, it kind of puts a divide there. It kind of creates almost like a duality approach. And that's what I want to eradicate. And that's kind of where my message is right now. I want to show people that it's just one beautiful, big reality. And let's call it a dream, because dreamlike means there's some magic in that, you know. And if we can see the whole reality that we experience, I'm talking about dream and wake, or wake and dream. If we can see it as one beautiful type of reality, which is just regulating at different frequencies, nothing else, to one's own perspective, I think the world will be a much better place to live in, you know. And I really do see the magic and beauty in the waking world now. It's gorgeous. And there is no pressure, actually, come to think of it, just to extend that point. There is no pressure now to feel that we must become lucid to have an experience to then get something back. And now for me, you know, 6-7 years on, I've now come to that point in my life where it's just, if it happens, it happens. If it doesn't, it doesn't. And for the times when I really am motivated, I will obviously, you know, create the intentions, put on some binaural music, set my intentions throughout the day, look at my dream journal, write down the dream. You know, it's a good practice to do when you really feel motivated to do. I say if you're just doing it to do it just to get something out of it, maybe you want a quick experience, and you just keep trying and trying and trying every day and not getting any results, I say just stop temporarily. Don't force it, because if you force anything, it will create a block. And then you'll think that, well, if it's not happening, there's something wrong with me. And that's not the case at all. It's just a case of when the time is right, the time is right. There's a higher intelligence, I feel, that gives us the experiences that we want when it's perfectly the right time. And it is teachable. It is, you know, anyone can do this. Anyone can do lucid dreaming and astral projection. But there must be a sense of dedication there, motivation, especially motivation, and interest and passion, you know. This passion really motivated me to do that. Without the motivation and the passion to take it any further, I wouldn't be wanting to teach it. So just to clarify, the perspective on life and reality for me is that it's all one beautiful type of big dream, if that makes any sense. That's just my perspective. We have the capability of visiting different worlds, different realities, different dimensions, and the answer is not out there. The answer is inside of us. We have the inner workings of an entire universe deep within us, and the answer and the key to our success and happiness is within us, without sounding too cheesy or cliche. It really is plain and simple. We don't need to build the biggest rocket ship to get to the furthest planet in our solar system. We don't need to. I'm not saying you don't have to. I mean, NASA can do that. That's fine. But the new paradigm, I believe, is that we really use the rocket ship of our bodies, our vehicle, our physical vehicle that we've been given, with this immense intelligence, because it is trainable. And we have a whole universe within us, and this is how we navigate consciously through time and space.
Any examples off the top of your head on conducting experiments in lucid dreams and having surprising results?
Yeah, one of the most fascinating experiments I conducted in the lucid state was when I wanted to overcome my fear in public speaking. It was always a fascination to me to share something which meant a lot to me, but I never had the guts to do it. You know, I was always so scared of even speaking to a small crowd of people, never mind a whole congregation of people. So this is one of the main things that me and my spirit guide worked on. And he would beckon me to follow him down a corridor at times, and then put me on a stage where I managed to create a big audience, and I would practice speaking to them about lucid dreaming, and I would teach them about what I knew, and they would be very attentive and they would listen. They enjoyed listening to what I had to say. And this really overcame a lot of fear for me. And I did this many times. I would find myself in other circles of conversation with spirit beings and projections, even subconscious projections created from my own mind would be there in the audience because they just wanted to listen in. And they would take note and they would listen to what I had to say. We had some very fascinating conversations, and it really built up a huge confidence within me that I can actually do this, because this is the beauty of lucid dreaming. The brain, as we know, thinks everything that it experiences is real. Therefore, if you experience something in the dream state, it is real. Your brain doesn't know the difference. Everything is real, which means also that it's creating new neural pathways and building new ways of understanding to help you to adapt to whatever situation. So if you are going into your dream state trying to get over the fear of public speaking, well then guess what? In the waking state, you've got an added sense of confidence now. And that's what happened to me. I found that I was unblocked now from speaking out, for not feeling tense, to the point where I was about to be sick because of the nerves I had in my stomach and the sense of a stiff neck because of all the nerves I had. You know, it was really, really tough for me. And I would just then just... It took a few months, though. I'm not saying it's instant. But for practicing in the lucid state, any type of fear, any dark or negative type of block that you may have, I thoroughly recommend that you practice it out in the lucid state, because anything's possible in the lucid state, anything. And I was very fortunate to bring that added confidence back, and I surprised myself, you know. Yes, of course there'll be a little bit of nerves inside me, but those nerves, I dealt with them in a different way this time. Instead of them consuming me and taking over me, there would be a higher confidence and intelligence within me that said, you know what, just practice what you've been doing in the lucid state. You've got this. And I would do it, and I would just speak out. And it was great. You know, I had very beautiful talks and workshops in England and France. I met some incredible people as well, and they seemed to enjoy it. So that was great. So it obviously works.
Could you describe some of the most memorable dream plans that you feel might inspire people to seriously pursue lucid dreaming? Any top tips you would love to share for those who do want to get deeper in their lucidity? As an extension of this, what are your favourite techniques and habits that keep the lucid fire burning strongly?
In terms of dream plans, you can try anything you want. I'd say it depends where you're at, how far you're down the rabbit hole as such. You know, like I said before, I think it's very important to recreationally get used to the lucid state. You know, you don't always have to speak to spirit beings on your first go. I get a lot of those questions. You know, I get a lot of people saying, you know, I've just started lucid dreaming and I'm trying to find my spirit guide. I'd say you've missed a step. I'd say just, you know, find your feet first. You know, get used to walking through walls and teleportation and flying, and you know, getting used to the feeling of, okay, I have an awareness now, an added awareness within the dream state. Now I need to elongate that experience for as long as possible. And this is actually, you know, speaking of a dream plan, here's a dream plan for you. I say, if you listen to this, and what is very common, you know, many people have a very, very small amount of lucidity. In terms of length, in terms of their experience, it's a very small, quick experience usually at the start of one's own dream life, if they've never really practiced it for a few years. And this is highly common and it's highly normal, so don't beat yourself up if you listen to this and it's normal. You know, I had this for many, many months. I'd always have these amazing experiences, but they'd last for like, what, 10 seconds, 20 seconds? Or I'd find myself rushing around the dreamscape, literally just walking around really fast, like a headless chicken, speaking to everyone, you know, I've got to get it in quick before the dream experience finishes, you know? So here's the dream plan. I think here's an idea. Why don't we learn to extend the dream experience in every session? I think this, to be the dream plan, can flower into so much more. You'll have, I mean, more dream time means what? Means more time to do the objectives you want to carry out, whatever they may be for you. And we do this with a fantastic technique called the DEILD method, which is the dream exit induced lucid dream, or initiated lucid dream. And basically, it's exactly what it says. You're extending the dream within the dream state. And we do this by getting a sense of, okay, now the dream state around me, or the lucid state, is starting to fade. And it will do. You know, you're aware that you're dreaming. The experience will last for however long it's meant to last. And every dream will have its day. You know, there's always a time limit. And you can actually sense this feeling just before it actually stops. And this is the beauty of this technique. And you get really good at it the more you practice at it. So the dream plan is, just before it starts to fade, and you look around, you have to be aware for this. So when you're lucid, you look around, and just before it's about to fade, you'll find that your dream body starts to weaken as well. You may fall to the ground because you can't sustain that lucid awareness for any longer. But you can. This is the thing. This is just, you know, all it's doing is that it's preparing you for the next dreamscape, the new environment around you. And what happens is you can actually hold your hands together, if you like, so that grounds you and it centers you, like clasp your hands. You can either keep your eyes open and watch what happens, or keep your eyes open. And what you can do, and what I did was, you can say repeatedly, I am in a lucid dream, I am in a lucid dream, I am in a lucid dream. And see it for however long it takes, until you actually drift off into the next dreamscape. And what happens is it goes really dark, usually. And then you look around and actually there's a new dreamscape formulating around you, like a virtual reality suite, like the holodeck in Star Trek, if you remember, if any Trekkies out there watching or listening to this. It literally materializes around you the next scene. But what happened was your awareness carried over to the next scene. And it's a wonderful thing. And you can actually, I call it dream recycling, really. You're actually recycling this energy over and over again. And I did this like 6 or 7 times in one night. And it's such an amazing feeling when you wake up feeling like you almost had a good workout, you know, a good lucid workout. And, you know, you've been extending these dreams all night. And it's fascinating when you get really good at it. Sometimes you can actually pop back to your body temporarily into the physical state. But the idea is to not move at all and carry on the mantra of, I am in a lucid dream, I am in a lucid dream, I am in a lucid dream. And then the sleep paralysis effect will continue to do its magic, and then you'll just pop back into the dream, or even an astral projection if you get really lucky. So, yeah, I think as a dream plan for the beginner and even the most expert level out there, I really do recommend, if we can become pioneers of extending our lucid dream time instead, I think the more dream time the planet has, or the more conscious dream time the planet has, the more fruits we can all share. I really do believe that.
And here's another wee break from the questions. This is Dennis Brown with The Love That I Can Feel.
Yes.
And now, absolute questions.
Any examples of information that was accessed in a lucid dream that you later validated in the waking state? Something that was beyond your own projections, specifically as Nick Barrett.
I had a fantastic precognitive dream, which was so validated, it was unreal. I spent some time with my spirit guide in one occasion, and he would be talking to me about Taoist dream principles and how the teachings have become so watered down through the ages that it's quite sad what information and what teachings humans have at this time. So it was a very deep conversation, as you can probably tell. And we were on top of this distinct looking rock. He sat on this big, I don't know, it was kind of, what size, like half a ton rock, just in the middle of this park. And it had like a slope on it, and at the top of the slope he would sit there and tell me about these teachings of the Taoist philosophy. And I would just be looking up at him from the bottom of this rock. And it was quite a miraculous time. It was really, really beautiful and healing, you know. So then obviously I came back to the waking world. I took a nature walk in southern France. And this is before I wrote the book, actually. This is towards the end of writing the book. And basically, I was taking a walk one day, decided to go off the path. I was in the forest somewhere. It's really beautiful around there. It's very wild and untouched. And I decided to go even more off the path because I'd like to do that. You know, I want to see where everyone doesn't walk. You know, I want to find out where that takes me. And so I ended up walking up this massive hill, going past a lot of trees and bushes, and then I came to this big plateau at the top where it all leveled out, and I was really high up. I could see this massive empty field, very flat, with pine trees all around the edge. And in the middle of this big field was the exact same looking rock as the one in the SGLD experience that I had with my guide 2 weeks before. And it was exactly the same rock. It had the slope on it. It was the exact same size. And it blew my mind. And I thought, number one, why is there a rock in the middle of a field? And number two, why is it the exact same rock that I was talking to my guide with 2 weeks ago in my dream? So that was the real first amazing precognitive dream that I ever had. It was so evident that it was for that reason. And it almost felt like, you know what? I think my guide wants me to come here and meditate next to this rock. You know, I think it's almost like a beautiful dance between the two realities. And this is another thing, if you've been reading my book, he talks to me through the number 8. So if I feel his presence is around, I would have a digital watch on my wrist. I literally just look at the time, and by the second it would turn from, say, it would turn by the second to the minute, sorry, the exact minute of 8. So it'd be like 1:07, and it would switch to 1:08. At the exact point, I would look at my watch. So it's very, very amazing. This happens time and time again, the number 8. So I know now that my guy represents the number 8. And it was beautiful. So I put it into the last chapter of the book, and I called it Cliftoff Rock, because that's his name, Cliftoff. And I would meditate next to this rock, and I would feel his presence there. It just made me laugh, you know. It's just like, this is just another type of dream, isn't it? It's just fascinating. And this thing that we love and cherish that we call, you know, this thing called time. Time is an illusion, because if you can experience something before it's happened, then time is just a construct of man's imagination. It really is. Which makes the waking reality even more dreamlike, yet grounded.
Can you share some examples of interacting with the awareness behind the dream, along with any words of advice about how to approach this awareness and strengthen the communication with it?
So this awareness that everyone speaks about behind the dream, you could call it the subconscious mind. I've interacted with it many, many, many times. And as well as interacting with these spirit guides and the spirits and people from different planets that want to share stories and that. And I would go about it in two different ways, with a subconscious manifestation, or not even a manifestation like a character, but even just to, you know, just beckoning out into the dreamscape as a whole. I would shout many things out, like, show me something spectacular. I did that one time, and all of a sudden this random character showed up and turned into one big massive firework, like a Catherine wheel, and it made a huge display in the dreamscape sky, and it was so beautiful. It was like so miraculous and amazing. I was like, wow, this is incredible. You know, show me something exciting and fantastic and amazing, and then there you go, you get to see it. But also you can say, you know, show me my fear about something, or you can just say, I want to heal the relationship with my mother, or something. You know, there's many ways you can actually call out and wait to see what comes back. Sometimes there is a block there, at times, with dreamers, I find. Dealing with some of the questions I get. Sometimes dreamers find that when they call something out, nothing appears. But that's just because there's a limiting belief behind that intention. You know, so you have to expect something to appear. And that expectancy has to be strengthened if it's not there. If you're not getting any results, which I find it hard to believe, because there's always something that would appear. But if it really is not appearing and there's nothing happening, and it's just static, then there is some kind of limiting belief there that may need to be strengthened. And we can do that through intention. You know, before you sleep at night, before your lucid induction, you could say to yourself, you know, tonight I will summon my subconscious and I will overcome my fear in such and such. You know, just completely drill that into your mind the night before. And the more you do that, the more progress you'd have, I think. So I've been doing that a lot. And of course you can summon spirit guides in the same way. But you need to be on the lookout for whether or not that spirit guide or that being is who they say they are. And I found this out by looking into their eyes. There's a distinct difference between a subconscious manifestation and a guide. I would always see the difference that, you know, a projection or subconscious manifestation as a character would be looking at me through me, like looking through me like a dead stare, like a robot. But within the eyes of a spirit guide or a being which had a soul like you and I, then I'd see a completely different look, and it would be very alive, very shiny, very vibrant eyes, you know? So that's one way you can see. Just to reiterate about the strengthening the communication between the subconscious mind and the dreamer, you know, it's all about what you do in the daytime, I find. What happens in the day and where your mind is at, this is how you program the subconscious mind to be effective. It's almost like you're priming the pump, you know, you're filling up a car in the day with gas or petrol, and then when it comes to dreaming, that's when it's activated. So it's all about what you do in the daytime, which then has an effect on the night's dreaming. So basically, the more you can do in the day, saying affirmations, saying that tonight I will have a lucid dream, tonight I will have a lucid dream. You know, you're actually, in essence, talking to your subconscious mind directly. And it will respond. And eventually, they say after about 30 days, you would have created a new habit. So if you do this every night, it'll just become a part of your routine. So always have a nightly routine to always talk to your subconscious, to build that bridge between wake and dream.
I asked my dreamer / awareness in the dream space what I should ask you, and it simply replied boomingly through the clouds, void. So here goes. Have you explored the concept of the void, or do you have any experience of lucidly being in a space that appears completely empty of everything?
I remember a few years back, I had an incredible dream experience, which you could call entering the void. Another good friend of mine and advanced dreamer named Peter Mesh, he actually visits the void a lot in his dream time, and he's become so accustomed to it that he can enter this if whenever he wants at will. But before I had any of those experiences, I did have something similar. I'm not quite sure if it is exactly the same as that, but basically it was I became very weightless in the lucid state, and I began to rise up, and all the dreamscape around me started to go white. It was like, you know, when you turn the fader up, and it was just becoming more white, and I'd just get more light and more weightless, and I was just floating and floating higher and higher and higher, and then before you know it, my whole body or sense of, okay, this is my dream body, these are my dream hands, all of that vanished. So in the end, I was just pure awareness mixed in with the white around me. And that for me was just incredible. I could only stay there for 5 or 6 seconds though, as completely formless. And it was unbelievable because I was just awareness in the space. And this space was infinite. It was all around everything. It was just pure white. And I was that space, and the space was white, and I was that space. And no sense of weight. Completely happy, completely beautiful, and but strange to say the least. Just because of the physical memory I had, which was still there. I still remembered what it feels to have a body. But having the opportunity to feel what that would feel like as pure awareness is such a gift, you know, such an amazing experience to have. So I think that is as close as I got to entering the void, I guess. But like I say, I could only be there for like 5 or 6 seconds, because after that it just got a bit strange. I wanted to return back. So when I wanted to, all I had to do was remember my body and go and have the will to go back. So I did that, and then poof, I entered back into my human body. And came away feeling very relaxed, very happy that I had that experience, and with a huge expansion on my perspective of what awareness is, you know. And I was very, very lucky to have that experience. I would say this. Lucid dreaming is completely subjective to the dreamer, and to the dreamer's beliefs, philosophy. It's very personal to what the dreamer feels and knows as reality. And those beliefs obviously carry over into the dream state, obviously, because it's all one thing. It's all part of one perspective. My perspective on dreaming will be different to another, though, and vice versa. You know, but there are times where we can dream similar things, but it doesn't mean it's exactly the same. For instance, if there is a dreamer who has a Buddhist teaching, and that dreamer practices Buddhism, then they would see, they'll probably see the Buddha or something in their dream state, because that's what they relate their experience to, you know. And that's how they wish to filter through, seeing through that filter. If you're a Christian, you know, you'd see Jesus probably, or if you brought up on the Christian faith. You'd see a lot of Jesus into your dream experiences. Or even the Taoist philosophy, it'd be more about letting go and not pushing and not labeling, and, you know, the Taoist philosophy. And so it is very subjective to the dreamer's experience and what spiritual beliefs they've had and what viewpoint they have on the world as a whole will deter what experience that dreamer has in the lucid state. But as a whole, the widened perspective of lucid dreaming and what it can give to a dreamer is what we can all share. And we have seen a track record of countless dreamers saying the same thing, which is, you know, I've been doing lucid dreaming for 2 months or so, and I had no idea that it was about this, you know. It's like you can only get a sense of the immensity and beauty of the practice once you experience it, once you get a taste for it. And this obviously carries over into the waking state. It's a widened perspective. And I'd say this is the number one thing lucid dreaming can bring someone's life. It's a widened perspective of a reality that you thought was so big. And then you lucid dream and then you see, wow, this reality is actually multi-diverse and with me, multi-dimensional. And now I can actually tap into these realities at will if I train myself correctly and get a wider perspective of experience. And that's essentially what we're talking about here. We're talking about experience. We are experience junkies. We came into this physical body to experience what it is to live a physical life. That's my philosophy anyway. And then at night, we have the freedom to investigate another type of reality that we now call dreams. One thing to point out, though, is that I think traditionally, in a Western approach, the word dreams is very, very much lost in translation. Again, I see it as another reality that we can all enter into. It's not this, you know, illusory world that the common person would feel that dreams are. And this is just my perspective, once again. This is me expressing what I feel dreams to be. The Aboriginal teachings, actually, one of the most oldest teachings of conscious dreaming, they would call it dream time. And this dream time, it wasn't just another fun time thing to do, or just one thing that is added on to man's experience, but it's actually another world, they would say. It's another world that one can enter into, you know, entering into dream time. And from there, this is the reality. We can work with ascended masters. We can work on some really deep stuff and bring back those gifts and bring back that wisdom to this waking world to make it a better waking experience.
As far as improving memory of the dream space goes, do you have any tips in particular you would like to share?
In terms of the memory of the practice, now, memory, or dream memory we could say, I think is one of the most important factors of the practice. Because if you think about it, the memory itself is the bridge between wake and dream. Without the memory, we have no recorded experience. There is no recorded experience either in our minds or on paper. It is literally just an idea that we quickly think we had, and then we think, okay, great, it was a dream. And then if we don't write it down, we just literally, what happens? We forget and it fades. But the great thing about memory now, as we know, scientists are working out that the brain is forever learning and it can be forever updated and it's forever evolving to whatever input we give it. So again, daily practice into strengthening this dream memory will build the bridge between wake and dream. And one of the best ways, I feel, I'm an old traditionalist when it comes to things like this. I really feel that writing down your dreams every night is the number one way to strengthen this dream recall. And there are other tips I can give you in a minute, but let me just go into this a bit more. The dream journal, it is so important. No matter where you're at in your journey, in the conscious dream journey, it is so important. If you're a beginner, if you're an expert, if you're a teacher, if you're just someone that wants to get into it and find out what's around the corner, you have to start recording your dreams daily. Always, 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 always do that. Always. This is your encyclopedia of yourself. It is so important and so beautiful when you read back through these dream entries. They hold so much information and they're actually boundless in time, because you can visit any dream entry years later and think, wow, I remember that. And you know what? It actually holds a bit of significance right now. They held so much information through dream symbols and beauty. And you don't have to, I think you don't have to write down, you know, reams and reams and reams, unless you want to, that's fine. But this is a great way, because what you're doing is when you're writing anything down on paper and putting that focus intent, you are quite literally talking to your subconscious mind at that time and programming, in essence, the intention that you're saying, you know, you're saying to your subconscious, dreams are important and I must take note. And that's what the dream journal does. It records this power. It records this information down so that you can revisit these experiences and build this dream recall. It's the number one way. Another way, another tip you can actually strengthen your dream recall is throughout the day, every hour, set your alarm to beep and just think about when it beeps, think about what you were doing 7 minutes before. Go back 7 minutes from that hour and think, okay, where was I 7 minutes ago? What was I doing? Go back in time as opposed to always forward, always forward, always forward. You know, if you do this every day, so basically if you can do it like 7 or 8 times a day on the hour and just travel back in your mind, skim through it like a movie, go back 7 minutes. It's wonderful. I don't know why 7 minutes, but you know, you could just, it's just a beautiful number to use. And just quickly skim through, where was I? What was I saying? Who are the people I was talking to just now? What was I doing? How did I feel? And what this does is this builds your memory fantastically. Over time, it can boost the awareness of being in a conscious dream as well. It can actually trigger a conscious dream as well if you get really good at it. So that's another great way. And I call it memory rewind technique.
Any favorite books that really added to your practice?
Yes, books that really impacted my dream life were Stephen LaBerge's World of Lucid Dreaming. It's such a beautiful book. It's very small to put in your pocket. You know, it's great. You can carry it everywhere, but it's actually quite in depth. There's, you know, there's a lot of reading in there. Great for beginners. And another one, though, that I will always hold close to my heart is a book called The Lucid Dreamer by Malcolm Godwin. And this one is a very unique book. It's very beautifully illustrated, which really just, it sort of ignites the interest and the inspiration to lucid dream, because the artwork in it alone is just breathtaking. And it talks about how the brain is wired, it talks about our perspective on the waking world and the similarities between the waking world and the dream world, which is really up my street, as you know. And he's such an incredible author. I really do recommend The Lucid Dreamer. Check it out. If you're a beginner as well, I've also got a small ebook series called Dreamscape, which I thoroughly recommend. It comes in 3 volumes, and it's great if you're just starting out and you just want to have a quick read. They're very small volumes, so it's very easy to read. But yeah, check them out if you're a beginner.
Could you share any anecdotes or experiences of yourself or people you know who have used the power of lucid dreaming to heal either physical ailments or psychological/mental troubles that you've found very inspiring?
Yes, you do hear across the board many experiences that dreamers overcome, you could say, with confidence issues, creativity blocks, you know, all of these you can have a boost in. All these areas will be magnified once you become lucid. And for me personally, I managed to overcome a lot of fears, as we spoke about before. The public speaking was one of my big ones. But also I had a lot of childhood issues still remaining deep within my subconscious. And the funny thing is, in these dreams, they kept repeating the same dreamscape, which for me was this family home I used to be in when I was about five years old. 5 to 10 years old, I was in this house. So most of these memories of when my mum and dad got divorced were in this house. And the local villagers at the time thought the house was haunted because it had a very old history. It used to be an old public house where people used to drink in, and there used to be some lurking spirits, you could say, in this house. So it was already quite mysterious and vibey, you know. So most of these experiences that I had, you know, the sleep paralysis, the feeling of someone at the end of my bed talking to me, even though they weren't in the house, were all taking place in this house, in this old family home I had. So what I decided to do was, you know, I asked myself one day, why is this dream symbol of this house, particularly the kitchen, why was this dream repeating itself? And then I came to the conclusion that it's the subconscious trying to get my attention about something. Maybe it's like unresolved issues or matters that's still within my subconscious mind, you know, 20-something years later. So these issues needed to be addressed. So I managed to set my intention the night before. I said to myself, you know, tonight I will become aware that I'm in a dream and I will visit my old family home in the kitchen. And I said this over and over again. And this is generally how I set my intention, as a mantra. And this repeated notion obviously quite literally, programs the subconscious mind to take note. It works on repetition and consistency, and that's how it forms a response. And so I would then appear, after setting this intention, I would then appear in the family home, and I would be aware, and then there would be this spirit talking to me, particularly a lady who now calls herself Leanne, one of my female spirit guides. And there she was, in the kitchen of this old family home of mine. It looked exactly the same as what I remember it to be. The sun was shining, the sun would be glaring through the kitchen window near the sink. And then she'd show me something. She would show me basically my body. But it was a holographic torso of my body. And she would operate this, and she would just show me that within there is a heart. And then she made me peer through to this rib cage, this holographic rib cage of my own body. And I would see my own heart beating right in front of me. And that was really something to witness. And she said that I'm blocked there, so I would need to open that up. And as I knew, as she told me about this, the feeling that I had was bliss. It was like, wow, okay, this is a real breakthrough. And the heart itself turned into this golden, beautiful, shiny, pumping heart. And then it would just explode. And for that experience to happen, I felt incredibly lifted upon awakening. And so I decided to study, you know, these dream symbols and work out what actually they meant. And turns out that the kitchen is a dream symbol for the heart, you know, because the old saying is, you know, the heart of a home is the kitchen. So if you find yourself in the kitchen, then maybe it's sort of like a mirror to your own body. You know, how well you keep that house tidy is how well you keep your body healthy, you know. There's very beautiful similarities there. And so the kitchen, to me, represented the heart, you know, and this was where probably I got blocked all those years ago in my childhood, emotionally and mentally, because I did have quite a stressful childhood growing up with my mum and dad's divorce. And a lot of the activity and arguments happened within this kitchen. So this would make complete sense. And obviously my subconscious recorded it all those years ago and never really forgave it. So in that moment, in that lucid state, I would be healing because I'm now recognizing what the subconscious mind's message is. I think at the end of the day, all the subconscious wants is for us to take note of its repeating symbols. You know, if something's repeating, whatever it may be, an object, an emotion, a reaction, it's something there which needs to be addressed because it's constantly repeating, trying to get your attention. What is not correct is something where it's repeating and we're just completely blindless to the fact that it is repeating, going about our day-to-day lives, just not recognizing the message. is really trying its best to get our attention, just to simply recognize it. And within that recognition, there is healing. So yes, I feel more healed with that aspect of my life now. I feel I've overcome most of my childhood issues that I had that were still lingering, and now I feel I can get on with life much more with an open heart, you could say.
Please tell us about your experience with your dreamer in regards to the radio show. Did you become lucid and get a response back directly from the dream awareness, or did you have any luck with asking in the waking state / setting a strong intention for what to cover on this show?
I did actually get some result with that. I managed to become not lucidly aware as such, but I was like semi-aware that I was in a dream, but sadly didn't recognize the fact that I was also physically sleeping in my bed at home. So they would call this semi-lucid. But the night before that, I set my intention and I said, I want to meet a character where I could get some advice about the dream space interview. And I kept saying this again and again and again and again with the mantra technique that I use. And I slipped into a semi-lucid awareness. And I was greeted by lucid dreaming teacher Charlie Morley, believe it or not. And he was there, and we were talking about what I remembered, the thing I was supposed to ask him, or ask the character. And I was saying, you know, can you help me? What do we talk about on this show? And what came back was what we have been talking about on the show so far, which is understanding the reality and the reflective nature of dream and wake. Primarily, and how both are beautifully laid out in front of us to be experienced, to be enjoyed, to be transcended, and yet both are from the same pool of consciousness and reality. So again, it's about this message I'm trying to get across, isn't it, which is to break the separation, you could say, from our waking state and our dream state. And this is not to be all airy-fairy and be ungrounded and just be floaty-woaty and not really being aware. No, we're talking about ultimate lucidity, ultimate awareness that you can bring over into this waking world simultaneously. Lucidity doesn't just happen in the dream state. Lucidity happens right here, right now. Right here, right now. It really does. And the more we can build this bridge between the two states, the more we can be lucid. Plain and simple. And so this is my mission, trying to understand it deeply myself, because I, you know, hand on my heart, I'm not saying I'm 100% there yet. I've still got so much to learn. And that's the best attitude, I think. You know, if you can be a dream researcher, if you listen to this and you're excited about dreams and you want to research more, always go in it with a state of mind that is, there is always more to learn, there is more to experience. You know, we don't know what we don't know until we've experienced it. There is so much more to learn about this. We're only scratching the surface. Even scientists, you know, dream scientists, you could say, still don't fully understand the nature of dreams or where they come from. They have theories, but they don't know where actually dreams come from. And this is what I love about the topic of dreams, because, and the topic of lucid dreaming, because it does leave you questioning all the time. It's incredibly mysterious, but that's just the fun of it. We get to day by day know more and more about it if we so wish to research more about it. I think the only way of truly understanding lucidity is if we delve deep within ourselves. It's not to build the next bit of tech, the next bit of technology that we strap to our heads, or, you know, the next best pill that we take that has all the galantamine inside it. No, it's about delving deep into our inner selves, the universe of our inner minds, and hearts, because I feel that that is where the real key to lucidity is. And you know what? I'm still yet to find it myself. I don't know how I know that. I don't know how I know that it's within ourselves, but it does feel right when I say that. And again, I'm only speaking as if I was, you know, I'm speaking through what I feel and not what, you know, is politically correct or whatever. I just want to just go off on my intuitive feelings on the subject and what I've experienced, in hope that maybe this might inspire you or whoever who's listening too, you know. So yeah.
Can you think of the last difficult time where the practice of lucid dreaming allowed you to see beyond your projections in the waking state and thus creatively and effectively deal with a troubling or difficult situation in the most peaceful and compassionate manner?
So one of the most amazing things that I experienced through researching my dreams and delving deep into my lucidity all these years was synchronicities in the waking state. And these synchronicities in the waking state seemed to occur more and more and more the more I became lucid at night. These synchronicities seem to occur in the most peculiar ways, you know, and they can happen at any time. And for me in particular, it was numbers. Numbers of a selection of numbers, specifically the number 8, as mentioned before. Number 8 kept repeating wherever I went, whether I'd be playing poker or something, I'd get a number 8 on a card, like 888. If I was walking one day and I happened to look down at that particular moment, there'd be an elastic band and it would be shaped like a number 8. If I get on a bus and I didn't know the number of the bus, it'd be the number 8 bus. And these synchronicities kept happening time and time again. Not only do I feel it's a message from my guide, you could say, I feel it's also there to show me that this waking world that we live in is not so fixed and not so solid as we believe it to be. Because these synchronicities that you see in the most peculiar way in the waking state, it makes you think, well, you know, it really is a very magical dream that we're in right now. It's a very beautiful waking dream that we're in right now. And it's a wonderful way of seeing life as well. And these synchronicities just confirm it every time. And it doesn't have to be numbers. I mean, many people experience these number occurrences all the time. I get a lot of emails with people saying, yeah, I keep seeing the number 555 or 111 or 1111 or, you know, 888. And a lot of people experience these numbers, but they can also happen with objects, you know, colors, animals. And again, if something keeps repeating, I want to say this again, if something keeps repeating, it's something that needs our attention. And that's great. It means that there's something out there, or in us, or within ourselves, that's reflecting this need to find out something. Now, this is where it really gets technical, because what if it's ourselves, our inner selves, that is sending out this beacon of, I just want to know more about existence, you know? And then the universe responds to it by reflecting that call and replies to it. And then through that act of replying, it shows up and materializes into this waking reality as numbers or repeating objects or even repeating dreams that we so often get. Maybe our inner selves are wanting this transformation, or, you know, maybe we're asking ourselves every day that we want to know more about the magic of reality, because that's really why we're here. We're here to find out where we came from, why we're here, and what to do with this life, right? You know, we're all on different degrees of understanding, but essentially I think we're all going for the same thing. So when I saw these numbers repeated, and I still do today, I see the number 8 at least 3 times a day, honestly, and it's just mind-blowing. It just reminds me of, yes, okay, this is completely a beautiful waking dream. And so it makes you feel then less serious about life. It makes you feel that this is another type of dream. great friend of mine, actually, an event organizer named David Farrell, who put on events, put on the Gateways of the Mind event. It's a very popular event. He actually came to one of my workshops and organized a few. And basically, he mentioned that when I told him about these repeated numbers, his viewpoint was very interesting. He mentioned that it could be a great way of checking one's reality. And it's true, I never really thought about it like that. You know, if you see something that repeats, that's a great time to check your reality. They call it state testing. And this is one of the techniques that we use to become lucidly aware within the dream state at night. But we do the work and the prep in the day. So when this repeating symbol happens, or something that shocks you or surprises you, check your hands immediately and say, am I dreaming? Am I dreaming? Am I dreaming? You can check your hands, or you can just simply look at the object and say, you know, next time I see this object or this thing, I will remind myself to check my hands in the dream state. You know, these little quirky things, again, they need to be repeated for it to actually, you know, formulate within the subconscious mind. Because if you don't repeat on a daily basis, whatever it is you're trying to repeat and state check, and reality check, it won't actually occur. So you need to basically do this day in, day out. And we're talking probably like 1 or 2 weeks, you'll start seeing the results. You know, many dreamers can even see it on day 3 of doing regular reality checks. So I really want to be quite adamant on that. It's very serious when we say you must do your daily reality checks or whatever that means to you. Do them, do whatever it is you do every day in terms of lucid practice, because it has to be a daily practice. It's like a muscle, you got to do it every day. So these numbers made me more compassionate towards others. It made me more open to the wonder of reality. And every day there is even more and more surprises that happen, these surprise occurrences. See, you need to be open to receiving these synchronicities for them to happen. Or maybe they're actually always there, but what's different now is that you now have been told or discovered one or two, and now you're making more focus and effort to actually look out for them. Therefore, you see more of them. It's like when you buy a new car, like say a Renault, for the first time, and all you then see on the road are Renault cars everywhere because you now have one. You know? And this is the beauty of the subconscious mind. But before, on the road, you didn't see any Renault cars. It's only when you started to look out for one or drive one that you did see one. It's like if you look out for the color red all day, you'd probably see the color red a lot more than you would do the color green. And I think these numbers, and even golden opportunities in life, you know, if you want to be more abundant, more prosperous, look out for that. Train your subconscious mind to be more prosperous and more abundant. Home in on that prosperity instead of focusing on the lack of what you don't have. Focus on what you do have. And that's where the law of and the power of gratitude comes into it. People say that when they just feel more grateful for their lives every day, it then formulates into more things happening, which makes you feel grateful about life. And again, it's like the sacred steps technique that I mentioned earlier. Feeling grateful for the dreamscape really opens up so many more doors and actually makes the dreamscape more solidified into the experience, makes you more aware, makes you more in the moment, makes the colors very vibrant, makes the details very crisp and outstanding. So why would that law that happens within the lucid state not happen in the waking state also? This is how my mind works. What happens over there can also happen here, just a bit differently, maybe a bit slower. So this is why we can really practice the art of gratitude in the waking state and then also beautifully operate in the same manner in the lucid state. And for me, that's such a beautiful thing. Try it out. I thoroughly recommend it.
What is high on your to-do lucid dream plans at the moment?
What is high on my to-do list for my next lucid adventures is to actually delve deeper into dream character interaction. And I know I've had a lot of experience with that already, but I feel there's so much more that I'm not quite understanding yet. Because dream characters are one thing. You know, working with the subconscious mind, as we know, is highly beneficial. But I would like to investigate more on the spirits that I would discover and other beings that claim to be from other planets of our solar system. I had a great conversation in the lucid state a few months back with a being that claimed to say that he was actually from Titan. I believe it's one of the moons from Saturn. And we would be talking, and he was quite reluctant to actually explain where and why he was there. It's almost like there is a code of conduct where they can't actually explain where they're from as such. You have to guess it. But yeah, I just want to delve into this more and then hopefully compile it into a new book. Just keep expanding, you know, just keep growing into this field of consciousness. And it is one path of many paths, I feel, in order to do this. You don't have to be a lucid dreaming master to understand the self. There are many different practices one can learn, I feel. But lucid dreaming and the art of conscious dreaming is one particular path in which I wish to take my life further into. I also want to refine the induction process. The induction process meaning, if I can find a particular route in which it works for me every single time at will, then I would like to keep doing it for many years and share that knowledge in hope that others will easily use the same method to induce lucid dreaming naturally. And this is the big question for me. What is the secret to everlasting lucidity? You know? So this is really on my to-do list. And it's a big one. It's actually just one big question for me. And this particular question gets me so riled up because I just really want to decode it. And you know what? Many lucid dreaming teachers out there and passionate dream researchers have the same question. What is the secret to everlasting lucidity? How do we manage to induce it at will, easily, naturally, anytime we wish? What is the secret to that? And that's why, you know, the market is saturated with new technologies, new herbs, or formulation of different herbs blended together to induce lucid dreaming, new techniques, you know, all of this stuff. But I think we need to move beyond all of that now. It needs to move beyond techniques itself. And that sounds ludicrous when you say it like that. I'm not saying that it's a bad thing. I'm not saying that at all. I've formulated my own techniques, you know, and I've also ingested many different dream herbs, and I've tried out different technologies that can induce dreaming. And I'm saying all of those are fantastic ways. But if you were stuck on a desert island and you needed to become lucidly aware within the dream state on command, and you had nothing on you, all you had was yourself, how could you do it is the question. How could you induce it? Could you do it? Or would you need your iPhone to show the latest dream app how to do it? Or the latest dream herbs? So for me, I want to decode this. I want to really find out how. Because we know that, you know, at this stage, we know that it usually comes about lucid dreaming when you use a multiple of different techniques at different times, you know, keeping them varied. Don't do them in the same order for too long, because then, you know, the subconscious gets used to it and then it will cause a block, and then you need to change them up a bit, you know. So use a combination of different things at different times. We also know diet has an effect. We also know intention has an effect. Belief has an effect. all these different variables in how to become lucid are at play here. So it can get incredibly advanced. We also know each of us bodies are different as well. You know, and everyone dreams differently. Everyone reacts to dreams differently. Everyone has a different level of dream memory. All of these factors are at play here. So are we saying then that there is no one size fits all mechanism? Or are we saying that it's just because we don't know who there is? I mean, they didn't know that about landing on the moon, and they did, you know. Or maybe they didn't, I don't know. All I'm saying is we can't write off anything before we experience it. I guess, you know, we're going to do more studies on this. We're going to get more dreamers in. And you know, there's new dream researchers coming out every day who are also taking a big step into this field. And I just feel that the more we just keep decoding and the more we just keep sharing with each other, eventually, who knows, we may have a one-size-fits-all natural mechanism in order to become lucid at will. Because induction is still an issue. It would be so nice if you could just tell your mum a few simple steps, you know, like maybe your mum's never done it before, she wants to experience it, and you say, "Mum, do you know what? Follow this, this, and this tonight. Do this, this, and this." Or over a couple of months or whatever, change your body in a certain way or something, and then you'll have lucidity at will, anytime. Try it out. And you know, you can say, you know, you got to keep practicing, got to keep doing this and this and this, but I just feel that there is too much effort at stake here. You know, a lot of my students always come back with that same feedback, which is, you know, there's a lot of effort here, there's a lot of time and effort you have to put into this. And it's true, you are like a you know, a dreaming athlete in the end. You have to be that type of, you know, unbreakable willed person. You have to be practicing daily in the daytime, religiously writing down in your journal, setting those intentions to become aware within the dream state, pondering on the fact, imagining where you'd be in the dream state, visualizing it, embodying that dream state mind, you know. And this can go on for months, sometimes years. You know, there is no quick fix solution here, guys. There really is not. But then also, you know, isn't that the journey? Isn't that part of the magic, trying to work it out? It's part of it. You know what, it's funny, you know, because literally just last night I became lucidly aware. I was actually an astral projection, and it was so beautiful. I came out of my body, I went out the ceiling, I flew off, and then it was very high definition forest I was in. Beautiful, it was very green, and I looked up and there were just trees. I couldn't even see the sky. The trees were that high. It was just trees, 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 all the way up. And I was in the middle of this clearing, and all I could see were these trees. I couldn't even see one speck of blue where the sky was, because I wanted to go up. And I was just looking up and I just saw these trees like overcast me. And I wanted to just fly up. So I flew up. I kept flying and flying and flying and flying and flying. And it was tough. I couldn't get there. No matter how hard I tried, I couldn't get to the top of the trees to see the sky. And then this huge message just hit me, because then it brought me back down to where I began. It said, you know what? It's not about forcing. It's not about getting to the end result every time. It's about the journey. And so I tried again with this new outlook. I started to fly up again and take my time in the moment. And I got higher and higher and higher, very slowly, in different increments, different levels, getting higher and higher and higher, slowly, 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 but surely and confidently, until I reached the top. And then I came out of the trees, and then I hit the sky. And it just is so synchronistic within itself, me even talking about this, because there I am trying to say, you know, there's this big question. Can we decode the secret to lucidity overnight? And it's not about that. It's actually more worthwhile for all dreamers and researchers to enjoy the journey, to enjoy the process of this huge, huge journey, and to enjoy it. We can't be in frustration with it. We can't be saying, oh, you know, it's been 2 weeks. I did all my reality checks. I've read all the books and still I can't get there. You know what I mean? It's like we need to enjoy the fact that we haven't got there yet. We need to be grateful for that. And you know what? I think when we get to that point, that is when lucidity will hit us hard. Because there's no resistance anymore then. You accept the fact that you have to take each step as it comes, each bit of timing, and eventually creep higher and higher and higher, become stronger and stronger and stronger dreamer. Your memory will become stronger. Your inspiration will become stronger. Your gratitude will become stronger until you experience the sky, the blue sky that was above those trees all along. But what it won't allow is for you to just teleport to that point, because it's all about learning then, isn't it? It's all about, it must be all about learning. But not just learning, it's about enjoying the learning process.
And now, I have two questions.
Do you have any dream plan in particular that you would really love dreamers to do next time they become lucid?
Yes. I just want to tell you one thing. When I tried out this lucid induction last night, I did this in a very particular way, and I want to share that with the listeners right now, if that's okay. I went to bed at 8 o'clock. 8 o'clock is very early, I know, but I'm still a bit jet-lagged because I'm still on UK time, even though I'm in Costa Rica right now. So my body clock's a bit strange. But I think if you can train yourself to get to bed about 8 o'clock, that's great. Get to sleep for 8. And then wake up at 3 a.m. Then at 3 a.m., read, write, saturate your mind with lucid dreaming for 48 minutes. And that's exactly how many minutes I was awake for, 48 minutes. Which incidentally as well is one of my repeating numbers, by the way. So I kind of liked it landing on 48. So 48 minutes, reading, saturating the mind from 3 in the morning, all about the topic of lucid dreaming. Now, what I'm not mentioning is, at 3 a.m., I instantly made a cup of coffee. Yeah, and you hear this a lot now. There's even, I think, a technique out there called coffee-induced lucid dream. C-I-L-D. Whatever next. But yes, the coffee seemed to keep me awake, which was good. I was planning on staying a lot later than that. But 48 minutes for me, drinking a nice cup of coffee at 3 a.m., saturating my mind with lucid dreaming, and then I went back to bed. I put on some nice binaural beats, lucid dreaming meditation music. And then I just drifted off to sleep. Oh yes, and I also set my intention. Let's not forget that. And I said, you know, I now appear in an astral projection, or I now have a lucid dream. Please allow me to experience lucid dreaming. And it was like a declaration, you know. You really need to stamp it down with your emotions. Don't just mindlessly say a phrase. It needs to have emotion and intent behind it. Otherwise, it won't work. So, I drifted off, and then I started to come up my body. And that's when I had that tree experience, trying to reach the sky. And so, I would like the listeners to try out that same technique, that same method, to see if whether or not that would take anyone there. 3 o'clock wake up with a cup of coffee, stay up 48 minutes whilst reading about lucid dreaming, then go back to bed with binaural music, drift off with intention. That's it. Try it. And for the next dream plan, I think, for you, for the listeners, for whoever's listening, why not try investigating these dream characters a little bit more? Some people don't even take note of these dream characters. Some people walk straight past them when they become lucidly aware, because it's just so amazing to be lucid in the first place. It's just too much to take in. Usually you start flying and or have sex with celebrities. That's quite common. Why not take a bit more notice on these characters and show them respect and find out where they came from? Who are they? Why are they in your experience, or why are you in their experience? Who knows? At that time, and find out who they are. Decode who they are. Maybe befriend one if they claim to be your spirit guide. Who knows? Try and befriend them multiple times after that, on a separate occasion of being lucid. That's really when the secret comes into it, I think. The power of dreaming, with spirit guide interaction in particular. If you can summon the same character 3 or 4 times, you're onto something really big there. And how do you know if it's them again? Because you'll intuitively feel their presence. Not just because they say who they say they are. You intuitively feel their presence. And you can feel this personality blueprint, or energy blueprint, in other dreams to come. once you become connected to that spirit guide. So that would be my quest, and for whoever's listening.
And we've got a question from a listener here who is asking in regards to a YouTube video of yours. When you talk about having your wits about you in regards to being taken down the wrong realm, you said this is something that had happened to you. So what happened when you went down to this wrong realm? And also regarding this, we note that fear and anxiety need to be confronted and that these paths must be walked. How does one differentiate between this and the wrong, the so-called wrong path, the wrong realm?
On my YouTube channel, the Always Lucid YouTube channel, there's a video on there and I speak about going down the wrong path if you ever are taken by a spirit guide or a being that is saying that they are your spirit guide. You know, what would happen in the event that they may take you down, say, a different dimension or a different type of realm, which was very unsettling. Now, this is to be expected because there were many times, you know, with me and Clifftop, that basically he would take me to other realms, which were very unsettling, fairly dark, and at times I was left alone once I got there. So we would dimension jump together by him asking me to grab onto him after I would say, you know, take me somewhere fun and interesting. Because I was like a little kid in a candy store. I thought, wow, I've got access now to the entire universe with this guide who can chaperone me anywhere I want. And he would say, yeah, okay, so grab onto me. So I'd grab onto him, and then all of a sudden my eyes would just go, or my vision would just go blank. I couldn't see where I was going. And this happened a lot. And I would find myself going through some kind of wormhole. I call these now dream wormholes. And they take you down different parts of the universe. I call these now dream wormholes because it just feel like when you're going through them, it's like Stargate, you know, that film Stargate, when they peer through the pool of energy, and then they get sucked through at lightning speed, going through this little tunnel, like, and then they end up in this crazy place, wherever that may be. But it wasn't really a Stargate as such for me. It was more like I would just have no vision. I would feel the sense that my dream hands and dream arms were wrapped around Clifftop's body, gripping on for dear life, because I knew that if I let go, I'd just be lost in the abyss. And it was such a weird sensation because I'd feel being upside down, then the other way, and then left and right. And I felt this immense speed going through this absolute black tunnel. So it was taking me somewhere. And that within itself is ultimate trust with your guide. You know, if he's taking you to some unknown place through a dream wormhole, and all you have is the grip of his body or her body, just the grip of that, holding on, that is ultimate trust right there, isn't it? And so there would be times where he would take me to this other realm. I only went there once, luckily enough, but if I could describe it, it was basically like hell, right? And you had the fiery pits, you had, it's like in this deep, darkened cave, just like the stereotype version of when you think of hell, what would hell look like? Well, that's what it looked like. And when I arrived there, he wasn't there. So he took me through this wormhole. I ended up in this hell-like dreamscape. I looked around, I'm like, oh my God, where am I? This is, I was like, Clifftop, where are you? And he was nowhere to be seen. And I looked across the way, and there were these, what I described in my book, Spirit Guide, Lucid Dreaming. I described them as crow people. They were like half man, half crow, or half type of bird type thing. very much like the ancient depictions of the gods of Egypt. Forgive me, I can't remember what kind. Possibly Thoth or another type of god, the Egyptian god. And basically, it's just like they have a head like a bird, you know, and they have the long beak coming out, and then from the waist down, and probably with human arms as well, actually, they would be human, you know, or giant-like, because these things are like 14, 15 feet high, really, maybe even taller. And I saw it coming towards me across the way, and I thought, oh my God, here it comes. And it was just like, you know, plodding along, and luckily it didn't really see me. So I thought, okay, I'm that small, I can just, you know, creep past it. I was fully aware, by the way, this is like a fully, fully blown, conscious dream experience here, or astral experience. And I was literally just, you know, walking past very, very slowly, creeping by, because I didn't want this huge crow human like god to look at me, because I was just so afraid. I felt fear inside me. I was like, oh my God, where am I? So I creep past him, and when I went past him, I accidentally scraped past his ankle, this thing's ankle, and it felt me brush against it. And then all of a sudden, I looked up, and it looked at me and went, quack, like squawked at me with its huge elongated head and its snout just pointing at me and squawking at me. And I thought, oh my God. So I just ran. And so I heard Clifftop shout across the way, down the way. He would shout, get in! And I thought, what's he saying get in for? I could see that at the bottom of this lane, this gravelly lane, there was this beautiful rainbow-colored treasure chest. It looked like a treasure chest, but it had a heart emblem on it. And it was all like rainbow-colored, all different colors. And the heart was the centerpiece of this chest. Again, it's a symbol of the heart, right? So it opened up, and I could see it. It was about 200 yards in front of me, and I knew I had to get in this chest in order to survive this crow man. That was the only way. Just running for dear life, jumping into this thing. So I ran. I ran. Quite clearly, this thing started running after me at lightning speed as well. And Clifftop was just shouting from within the chest. I could hear like an echoey sound of his voice bellowing out, get in! So I jumped in, and then I could feel the claws and the touch on my feet from this thing's embrace or grip or whatever you want to call it. I could feel it on my ankles as I was sliding down this chest just in the nick of time. It's very much like when Indiana Jones went underneath the closing door, and then he left his hat on the other side. He had to quickly grab his hat. It was literally at the last moment possible, by the millisecond, that I managed to escape from this thing. And I did. And then we ended up going through another wormhole through this chest, where he would then appear. And he would explain to me that this was like a test, and that I succeeded, thankfully. And it was like a curveball he threw at me. You know, why would he send me down to what seemed like my version of hell, to then trust in the fact that this heart at the end was the key to my survival? So it's all metaphoric, you know. It's all representative. Sorry, of the power of the heart in times of fear. It's a very deep lesson for me when he taught me that. You know, no matter how scary it seems to be, or appears to be, you've got all these things chasing you, you've got fiery pits of hell burning your face off, you can always turn into your heart and choose love, primarily. And to trust in that as well, because if you trust in the power of the heart, it can get you further, take you to places that you thought were not possible. And so he very, quite literally, showed an opportunity there, a doorway in which I had to jump through, which then made me be more open to the loving energy after that. Again, it relates to the other time that I mentioned before on the show. It seems to be repeating again, to open up one's heart to fully embrace what's real and what can dissolve fear primarily. So that was an example of one realm where my spirit guide took me down a place which was very, very extreme, very scary, and yet at the end of that was a very valuable lesson and transformation. But there are those other occasions where when I was trying to find out who Cliffdoff was to me, I would find other spirits that were claiming to be him, and they quite literally took me down a different place altogether without having my intentions, my good intentions at heart. For example, I remember summoning Cliffdoff. I was shouting, "Cliffdoff!" And then all of a sudden, this random guy came across as nice on the surface, but a little bit odd. And I only met Cliffdoff about five or six times before that in different dreams. So I was still fairly fresh to the relationship, you know. Still the honeymoon period. And this spirit, most definitely a spirit, not a projection of the subconscious, but definitely a spirit, he would claim to be him. And I'd say, "Are you him? Is that you?" And he'd say, yeah, it's me, yeah. And then I'd say, "You seem different." So it was like a Red Riding Hood, you know. You've got the wolf, and the wolf is saying, "Yeah, I'm your grandma." You know, I say, "Grandma, what big teeth you have, you know." There's something not quite right. It's an impersonator of your spirit guide, whoever this spirit entity is, and is mischievous. You know, I could feel instantly, intuitively, that this wasn't right. So that's the number one factor right there. That's how you can tell, just by getting a sense presence of who this being is or who they are claiming to say they are. So he was definitely lying to me, this thing. And he had a hat on, he had the raincoat. He was a little bit overweight and spoke differently, different speech pattern, to what, you know, different wording and different vibe, you know, just different. And he, I says, "Where are you taking me?" He says, no, it's fine, come with me." He literally just aggressively grabbed me by the arm, by the dream arm. I was like, "Where are you taking me?" He says, "It's okay, come down here." And then all of a sudden he got a knife out, like a dagger, started stabbing me in the side of my dream body repeatedly. And because I knew exactly that it was a dream, I knew exactly of my lucidity, and it was a very strong awareness at that time, I looked at the knife and I thought, "What are you doing?" I didn't feel any pain. There was no pain whatsoever. It was just annoying, you know. I could just feel him trying to get a reaction out of me more than anything. And I was like trying to get free from his embrace, and he's just constantly stabbing me on the side, saying, "It's okay, come with me, it's okay." And he's just like crazily stabbing me. I'm like, "What are you doing?" Anyway, I managed to break free, and then I pulled myself out of the dream. Because that's what you can do. You just think of your body, or you could lay flat on the floor, but I had no time for that. So I just forced the intention to pull me out of the dream. And it was very easy to do. It's very easy to do if you know how to do it, you know. You just think of your body and then boom. So that was nice. I could just pull myself out because it was just uncomfortable. And this spirit who was impersonating my guide quite clearly was just wasting my time. He was just, I don't know what he was doing. Maybe he was trying to cause fear to feed off it. Because I've heard that there are these entities which feed off fear as a food source. Quite literally, they, you know, in terms of food, and for them to eat to survive, they need to create fear, and then they go in the dream world. You could call it a nightmare if you like. And they would feed off that, and that's their food source. So I pulled myself out, and that was it. But then I came to another experience which was very unsettling. But I managed to learn a great deal from it. And there were these three female witches, you know. But they also had fangs, so they may have been vampiresses, I don't know how you call it. Like female vampires, basically. But they're also very witch-like, very dark. And I was in this very nasty, dark ruin castle type thing with no roof. It was lightning, it was dark, it was raining. These three witches were just trying to convince me to stay with them and just be with them, almost sexually as well, by the way. And I did some research on this, and I found out that they could be called succubus or succubi for the plural. I don't know. Succubus, anyway, for one of them. And there were these basically female demons that would feed off males' sexual energy. And this can actually give off wet dreams as well. And I have a theory about that too, but I'm not too sure if I want to get into that right now. Because the more attention you give it, the more energy you give it. But just to cut a long story short, they would be quite sexual with me, and I would try and fight them off as much as I could, you know? I would just fight them off. And the only way to escape them, because they were really, really strong. I mean, they would just follow me. I would change the dreamscape and they would follow me into that next dreamscape. I would change it again. They would follow me again. It was very much like Mortal Kombat when you change levels and you go to a different platform after beating someone up. You go to a different platform and they just kept following me. Again, irritating, annoying. And I just said, I tried to show them love as well. And they say that's the best thing. If you have any type of shadowy figure coming at you, show them love and it would dissolve. But with that, there is a slight problem with that, because that doesn't work every time, you know. And for me, it didn't work at all. I was just like trying to show them non-sexual love. I was just like, you know, look, ladies, please, let's just all get along. Can we just get along, please? I want to enjoy this lucid experience and maybe share some anecdotes with you or something, you know. And they just weren't having any of it. They just tried to bite me. They were scratching my face. I didn't feel any pain, again. But they just, again, tried to cause fear, I think, for a food source. But they can also feed off sexual energy as well. Sexual perversion thoughts and all that. And so it comes as a package, really. And I was practicing a very pure mindset at that time. So they would... they would almost be attracted to that, because if they know there is a lot of that purity there, that's like a deep pan pizza right there. That's a full 5-course meal right there for them. You know, the more work you do on yourself, the more pure it gets, the more challenges you get, really, especially to these dark forces. But that's just it. It's a test. It's a test of will, test of strength, to see how you deal with it. And so the only way I could deal with it in the end with these three witches was to actually just fly away. Literally just fly away. And I flew really high. And they would fly after me. But I flew so high that basically I did a sonic boom or something. I don't know. So I went really far high, like really high. To the point where I lost all sense of self and I was like, and then they couldn't keep up in the end, thank God. They were almost trapped in this realm where they just stayed there, you know. And what I didn't say just then was I put my hands together in a prayer formation, you know, like as you were praying kind of thing. And I went to love, I went to my heart chakra. And I channeled the energy there and I said, I am love, I am love, I am love, I am love, whilst flying really high at lightning speed. And that seemed to get me through the dark realm into a higher realm, a realm in which they could not get to. And fear was not welcome there, you know. So Yeah, it's quite mind-blowing when you have these experiences. It makes you question, you know, who are these beings? Good and bad, you know. Why are they harassing me and why are they inspiring me? You know, you got two sides of the coin here. And I really want to research this more and hook up with other dreamers out there that are having these experiences. So if you are experiencing these other beings and you've got some great stories about maybe seeing your guide in the dream state or incredibly keen to know more, please get in touch with me. I have an email address that all dreamers can get me on, which is info@alwayslucid.com. I've also got my website, www.alwayslucid.com. I have an online course as well called Unlock Lucidity, where you can join our ever-growing community with a 16-video video training program, which I created, which is fantastic. You can read the reviews on the Always Lucid site as well to see what dreamers are experiencing and what results they're getting. And the results have been absolutely positive. So we're really, really pleased about that. But yeah, thank you so much for having me on your show. And it's just a pleasure to share all of these crazy stories I have. So thank you very much. Thank you.
Thanks a bunch for coming on the show and being a great sport with all your answers, Nick. It's been good fun. Cheers.